that you join us, for those joining us in person, and for those who are joining us online, we welcome you one and all. Here we are to celebrate this season where we celebrate the birth of Jesus. And he is Emmanuel. That means God with us. God is with us. He is with us. He came to be with us. God made flesh, dwelt among us. And he is with us here in his presence amongst his people this morning. So we're going to join our voices as we stand and sing at this time. Let's join our voices together and sing Angels from the Realms of Glory. Let's join our voices. Come and worship.
Come and worship. Worship Christ, the newborn King. God is with us. Even now, his love is here. Come and worship. Worship Christ, the newborn King. God is with us. Even now his love is near, his love is near. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises.
Come you here, Lord Jesus.
Oh, come have your way
among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
This morning, Emmanuel, God with us. On that same theme, we're going to introduce a new song. It says, Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, King Jesus, the Savior of the world is born. Really simple. I'm just going to just introduce it to you. It says, Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, King Jesus, the Savior of the world is born. Emmanuel, God with us, Emmanuel, King Jesus, the Savior of the world is born. Pretty easy, huh? I think we can get that. That's pretty easy, okay? So let's sing this. God has been with us. His faithfulness has been with us, and it still continues to be with us this day. And that's the reason that we sing this morning, to praise the Lord for his faithfulness in our lives. He is still with us, and we praise him this morning. So let's sing this together. Go tell.
Go tell it on the mountain. The one that we've been waiting for, the King of our salvation, born on this day, our Savior Christ the Lord. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere, that we can be forgiven.
Here we go, the chorus. Emmanuel.
Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, King Jesus, the Savior of the world is born. Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, King Jesus, Savior of the world is born.
Go tell it on the
in the manger lay, mercy sent from heaven, angels fill the sky with highest praise. Emmanuel, God with us, Emmanuel, King Jesus, Savior of the world is born. Emmanuel, God with us, Emmanuel, King Jesus, Savior of the world is born. Go tell it on the mountain, this baby born of virgin birth, the ruler of all nations, the glory of our God has come to earth. Emmanuel, God with us, Emmanuel, King Jesus, Savior of the world is born. Emmanuel, God with us, Emmanuel, King Jesus, Savior of the world is born. The Savior of the world is born. Savior of the world is born.
Great singing. You may be seated. This morning we celebrate the faithfulness of God. God has been faithful in every respect, isn't he? I mean, if you could tell the story of your life, I wonder what one word, if you could encapsulate it to one word about your testimony and your experience with God, I'm curious what that would be like. I think for each of us, it would be a different story, and that just magnifies the diverse glory of God. For me, I know personally, I see the story of God's faithfulness in my life again and again, and it just makes me love him all the more. I look at myself, I see my own wandering heart, I see my own unfaithfulness, but I see his glory. I had a friend who told me one time, he said, for every one look at yourself, take 10 looks at Christ. Isn't that good advice? Isn't that good advice? Because then you become what you think about, you know? You are what you think about. And the more we want to be like Christ, the more we realize that we don't cut the job description, you know. It's only the Lord. But the Lord tells us to come to him. He tells us to come because he is faithful. this morning as we have this time of worship through giving and our as we reflect on the goodness of God in our lives, we think of his faithfulness and we think of our unfaithfulness, but he is faithful through it all. This song is interesting. It says, "O come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant." But this song says, "O come all ye unfaithful." Is that okay? Can the unfaithful come to God? I hope so, because that's me. But he is so faithful, and so we just magnify him this morning. So you can just sit back and just take it in. We don't normally do a special music, but this morning we're going to do that. So you can just sit back and just take it in, like a Selah moment, okay, if you will. A moment where you can just meditate on the faithfulness of God. Here we go.
Worship team. Good morning, everyone. Oh, wow. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
All right. And I realize I forgot one more thing.
So I'll be right back.
I know, it's one of those mornings. It's cold, It's a bit dreary. I know it's supposed to rain today, but you know, whenever we get gathered together to worship, it is a warm and it is a refreshing time. I had the privilege of speaking with some friends I haven't seen in a while from a church I used to attend who have not restarted in-person services yet, and they're hoping to restart their service next week for Christmas, and they need to get some things checked out with their building, but man, I just saw their longing to gather in person, and we've been doing it for a while, but I pray and I hope that we don't get used to it. You know, we were without fellowship together for over a year, and it's been a great privilege and a pleasure and a joy to be back, and I hope that's something we won't get sick of. And another thing I hope we won't get too used to is just the fact that the church is a place for the broken, and the church is a place for the faithful and unfaithful alike. And may it be true of CI that we are welcoming to all who would enter our doors. So thank you for that wonderful song. At this time, I would like to excuse and dismiss our kids to Children's Church. Thank you for staying and singing with us. And as we draw closer to Christmas, I'm sure all of you guys have so many things going on, you know, whether it's getting Christmas cards out the door or finalizing your invitation list and your menu if you're hosting and buying gifts. There is so much to do during Christmas. But for today, as we enter into our time of coming before the Lord and getting into His Word, for the pastoral prayer part, I would just like to lift up all the opportunities we will have to be witnesses for Christ in these upcoming weeks. All the people that we're going to see, perhaps some you're looking forward to seeing with great joy, and perhaps some you are dreading to see. But maybe it is especially for those that we need to pray for, that whatever circumstances God may bring us to, that He will give us opportunities this Christmas season to share the joy of the coming of His Son. So let's pray. Father God, we thank You that yet again it is the Christmas season. Lord, we know that this comes around every year, but Lord, for believers, it is always new. It is always exciting. At least it should be. Lord, may we never get tired of the celebration of Emmanuel, the God with us, the coming of Jesus in the flesh to take away the sins of the world, or to pay for the debt that we cannot. Lord, as we head into the busyness of the next few weeks, may You help us not to lose sight of the reason why we are celebrating, of the reason why we are gathering, the reason why we give gifts, the reason why we see friends and family. Lord, may You bring to our hearts and minds, even now, Lord, those who, Lord, need to know You, those who perhaps we're feeling a little stressed out about seeing. Lord, we don't know how it's going to go. But Lord, may You help us to see that it is especially those who are difficult, those who, Lord, may not make it easy, that we need to reach out to, that need Your Son the most. So, Lord, I pray that You will help us even as we prepare our homes, Lord, our trees, our decorations, our mailing lists, our cards. Lord, help us to prepare our hearts. Help us to not only have a right reflection and a right celebration of the birth of Christ, but also, Lord, help us to have hearts that are open to share, to seize any opportunity to be witnesses for You. Lord, to share in the excitement of the shepherds, the wise men, and all who had the privilege of hearing about the birth of Christ, Lord. To share in their joy and their excitement to tell others. Lord, I pray that, Lord, all that we do this Christmas season, Lord, will be for Your glory. As we turn to Your words today, may You prepare our hearts, and may You help us to not walk away the same. Lord, help us to be changed by Your word, Lord. And we pray these things in Your Son's name. Amen. All right. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn to the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 1. We are continuing in our series of Christmas in the Old Testament. I kind of like to call it Christmas before Christ. We are looking at passages surrounding the birth of Christ that refer to passages in the Old Testament. Now, this has led us down some interesting places, places that you probably don't expect. Many of these verses are familiar. You sing about them. You probably read them as part of your own Christmas celebrations. You see it on cards, in devotionals. But as we take a deeper look, there is so much depth and richness when we look at the connections between the Old Testament and the New Testament, especially around the birth of Christ. And today, it will be no different. Today, we're going to go to some perhaps weird places as we look at the passages that we will be in today. And what they're really talking about, just to help us be in the right mindset, it's really talking about two sons of God that had very different paths, as we'll see in these verses. And that got me thinking about this topic of brothers, siblings, but specifically brothers. Now, if you think about brothers who are perhaps famous in history, they either turn out one of two ways, right? They're either so aligned, so closely related that they are just referred to as the blank brothers, such as perhaps the Brothers Grimm. Now, just a show of hands, do you guys actually know what were the first names of the Brothers Grimm? Does anyone actually know? I didn't, but, Jacob, not according, oh yes, you're right, Jacob, yes, one is Jacob. So I didn't even know that, well, I had to write it down, and I still forgot. So one is Jacob, thank you, Susanna. Does anyone know Jacob's brother? Wilhelm, yeah, you're like, who cares? It's the Brothers Grimm, they do everything together. They are famous for perhaps giving Disney all of their movie ideas because they are collectors and editors of German folktales, right? Some of the famous stories you might have heard that came from them are Cinderella, Little Red Riding Hood, Hansel and Gretel, Rapunzel, Sleeping Beauty, Snow White, right? Like I said, Disney owes a lot to them. There's also the Wright brothers. And now you probably know their names, right? Orville and Wilbur. They were the ones credited with having the first manned flight. Very big pioneers in aviation, and an interesting note about them, both of them were high school dropouts. They did not finish high school. Now, kids, before you say, see, Mom and Dad, that was different times, and you should finish school, okay, guys? And for a little more recent example, they are the Russo brothers, which some of the younger folk may know. These brothers are responsible for directing some of the biggest and best-reviewed Marvel movies recently, including some of the biggest movies of all time. And yet, they are known as the Russo brothers, a directing pair. So, usually, if brothers do really well, they tend to be thought of together as a group, almost inseparable or indistinguishable from each other. But brothers can also go a separate way. This gentleman here, his name is Richard Two Guns Hart. Okay, and he, as you look at him, you're like, he looks like a cowboy. He kind of was. He wasn't born during cowboy times, but he had an interesting life. He ran away from home at the age of 16. He joined a circus. He allegedly fought in World War I. And later in life, he became a federal agent and a U.S. Marshal who hunted bootleggers and wanted killers in the early 1900s. That was already pretty cool. But the interesting thing about him is that his real name was actually James Vincenzo Capone, because he was the eldest brother of perhaps the most famous gangster mobster in history, Al Capone. Right? Kind of crazy. I did not know that the oldest brother of Al Capone was hunting and putting men like him in jail. As interesting a movie as this would have made, they did not actually really know about each other until much later in life, because James ran away from home. So apparently when Al Capone, who was already in prison, found out that his older brother was his lawman, he was disgusted and ashamed. Kind of interesting. If you know anything about the Capone family, I think like three of the brothers were noted gangsters. So apparently this guy, James, is the black sheep of that family. Imagine that. You're the lawman and you're the black sheep. Today's story and passage that we're looking at in Scripture also portrays a strange sibling relationship, a story of two sons of God. One that we will see in Matthew, surprised that it's talking about Jesus, and one that we will see in Hosea. Understanding these passages properly will not only help us understand the role and importance of every detail of Jesus' life, but also give us a better understanding of just how does prophecy work in Scripture, and how is Scripture even written to us? So without further ado, let's take a look at our passages for today. I believe I put it backwards here. So we're going to look at Matthew first, actually. So Matthew, and I said chapter 1, excuse me, chapter 2, Matthew chapter 2. We're going to be looking at verses 13 and 15. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Now, this is a familiar passage to us. We understand the story. Herod wants to kill Jesus. He doesn't want another potential king challenging his reign. And he did a horrible act, which we'll actually read about later, wherein he killed all the baby boys in that region. And according to Matthew, this was prophesied with this verse, "Out of Egypt I called my son," which is a reference to the second passage we're looking at today, Hosea 11, verses 1 through 2. This is what Matthew was referring to. Starts out well enough. It says, "When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son." The more they were called, the more they went away. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and burning offerings to idols. So once again, as we take a look at the passage in Matthew, right, detailing the birth of Jesus, and Matthew is pulling in all of these prophecies to show that Jesus' coming was something foretold, and Jesus came to fulfill all of these prophecies, we're left with something that makes us scratch our head a little bit. It's like, really, Matthew, out of all the verses you go to, you want to highlight this one in Hosea? This is talking about Israel, and how Israel disappointed God. How did Israel, the more God called to them, the more they went away from him. The more God loved them, the more they turned to other gods and sacrificed to idols. This is the verse you want to link with Jesus. And passages like this have given people who study the Bible seriously some headaches. People are questioning, well, how is this inspired? Because we really can't pick and choose the verses we want to use the same way Matthew does. At least we shouldn't. What does it mean that Jesus fulfilled this prophecy? "Out of Egypt I called my son." As you're reading this passage, you're probably thinking, that doesn't even sound like a prophecy to me. That sounds like, you know, Hosea is just describing what Israel did. How is this a prophecy? Did it need to be fulfilled? What does it mean? What's the importance that, okay, Jesus spent some time in Egypt, so did Israel. What's the big deal? Right? Was Matthew just trying to pull any verse he could to make his argument that Jesus is God? What is he trying to say? I luckily for us, I believe that Scripture is inspired. The Old Testament is inspired. The New Testament is inspired. I believe that Scripture proves that. And I believe that there is definitely thought and meaning and connection between these verses. Matthew was not grasping at straws. So let's take a closer look. Let's take a look at these two sons that God called out of Egypt and see how they're connected and see why was it that Matthew wanted to make this point. All right, so the first big idea is this. When we look at, if we're sticking with the passage in Hosea, when we look at Israel, this is the first son chronologically that's mentioned, we're looking at a sonship that failed. Israel's experiences in Scripture, with all its ups and downs, can really be summed up as a warning for the rest of us. Unfortunately, Israel, as much as they were supposed to be a role model and a good example, most often we look to Israel as an example of what not to do. They are a lesson to us about about failure. See, Israel was the son that failed. Israel was, for lack of a better term, the black sheep. But it didn't always start this way. And God certainly had great plans for Israel, and he still does. See, Israel's creation was there to proclaim God's gracious plan. From the very beginning of Israel as a nation, God wanted to use Israel to proclaim his gracious plan to the world. And it all starts in Exodus, right? It starts in Egypt. If you remember Exodus chapter 4, verses 22 to 23, as God was preparing Moses to confront Pharaoh, to demand the release of his people, he says something very interesting. He's coaching Moses on what to say, and he says in Exodus 4, 22, he says, "Then you shall say to Pharaoh, 'Thus says the Lord, Israel is my firstborn son. And I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me.'" This is one of the first times that God explicitly refers to Israel as his son. Not just any son. This is my firstborn son. This is the inheritor of my riches. This is the inheritor of the responsibility that I'm giving him. And this is why you need to let him go. He is not your slave. He is my son. And this is even the reason why the 10th plague on Egypt was the death of the firstborn. God goes on in this very verse to say that if you don't let my son go, I am going to take your son. And that gives us an idea of why God did things the way he did. Israel, from the very beginning, was God's chosen firstborn son, and it came with responsibilities. As God continues in Exodus 19, he details, well, you're my son, I've saved you, I've brought you out of Egypt now, what do I want you to do? And he tells them, Exodus 19, verses 4 to 6, he says, "You yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you," God's talking to Moses again, "shall speak to the people of Israel." So what was God's plan for this son, this firstborn son? What was God's plan for Israel? That they would be a kingdom of priests. The entire nation was to be a priesthood, a holy nation that's set apart for him so that the rest of the world can know who God is. They were to represent God to the rest of the nations. This is in fulfilling God's promise to Abraham that through you, all the nations of the world, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Blessed through his descendants who will then be a priesthood to the rest of the world. To show what it means to be in relationship with God, to be a son of God, to live in intimacy with the Lord. And this, rightly so, the Israelites were proud of this heritage, which is why in Romans 9:4, even as Paul is going on in length about how the Israelites failed, he had this to say about their heritage. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. This was what Israel was born and raised to be the foremost worshipers, to be the ones to receive God's law and God's promises and therefore bless the world. But as you know, if you've read any part of Scripture, this is who they were supposed to be, but Israel failed spectacularly. Israel failed. Israel rebelled against God. And they provoke God to a lot of things. They provoke God to judgment, which we see in throughout Scripture. God had to punish them and chastise them many times, often bringing them to the brink of destruction. And yet, through it all, the one thing, one constant thing that Israel's rebellion provoked was God's faithful love. Right? The failure of Israel served to highlight the faithfulness of God. And now it makes more sense why we are referring to the book of Hosea, right? In Hosea, we read the verse in 1 and 2, how, right, out of Egypt I called my son, but the more I called, the more they turn away. You know, instead of being a kingdom of priests to me, what did they do? They worshiped the Baals. They worshiped idols. They were priests to other gods, right? They completely rejected their birthright. And yet, as God looks at all their faults, all their failure, all their rejection, he says this in Hosea 11:8. He looks at them, even now rejecting him, he says, "How can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim?" Other regions God had cursed and rejected. "My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender." See, when God called Israel his son, it wasn't just a metaphor. God meant it. As any parent will know, when your child royally blows it, when they break your heart, right? There is hurt, there is pain, there is often righteous anger, there is punishment. And yet, as you look at your son or daughter, right, you have that same feeling. How can I give you up? You are my child. I hope that is true of all the parents here. I know some people are like, well, my kid really tested that. But I hope you would have that same feeling, that idea that this is my child. No matter what they do, right? Yes, there's punishments and consequences, but I will never give you up. My compassion grows warm and tender. And this helps us understand the first son that we see being referred to, Hosea, referring to Israel, the son who failed. Right? There was great promise and potential. He was given great privilege and responsibility, but he failed, walked away, and God is the one reaching out in faithful love. And that leads us to the second and greater son that we see, Jesus, in whom we see the sonship is fulfilled. Jesus, his sonship is fulfilled. If you read the book of Matthew, we've gone through several passages already. Matthew goes out of his way, as I mentioned before, to try to over and over say, hey, Jesus is here, and look at all of the passages in the Old Testament that talked about his coming. Look at all the ways that Jesus has fulfilled all of these prophecies. Even in the very beginning of Matthew's book, if you flip back over to Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. Very interesting way that Matthew opens his book. He says, "The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham." Right? This is Old Testament language. This is language that you see in Genesis over and over. This is probably, for those of you who tried reading through Genesis, some of you may have struggled. These are probably the bits you struggled with, the genealogies, right? As you go through Genesis takes time to say, well, this is the book of genealogy of Adam, of Abraham, of variety of other folks in Genesis. Throughout Genesis, it's just genealogy after genealogy. And you may wonder, well, why is this? Well, because Genesis is the book of beginnings, right? That's literally what Genesis means. And it's all about giving a history of not just where people came from, but where the nation of Israel came from, and where sort of, how did we get to this point today? Where did everything come from? And Matthew is starting over from the beginning. He's saying, hey, Jesus, he's like one of the patriarchs. He deserves his genealogy to be traced, like in Genesis. So from the very beginning, Matthew takes great pains to try to parallel, hey, Jesus' life reflects the experiences of Israel from the very beginning, even from his genealogy. He is the son of David, the son of Abraham, the two of the most notable Israelites. But it goes deeper than that. We don't have time to go through every single passage, but we start seeing what Matthew is trying to do. Right? As he continues on in Matthew 1:23, this is the famous, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. Right? He's relating that to the promise in Isaiah. In Matthew 2:6, he refers to Micah and identifies Bethlehem as the birthplace of Christ. And it gets now even more specific. Now, with this passage that we just read about the flight out of Egypt, now he's saying, well, just like Israel, Jesus was in Egypt and he had to come out of Egypt. If you consider even the experiences of Jesus in that point, you can see a lot more parallels to Israel. Herod wanting to kill the children. It mirrors what Israel went through when Pharaoh ordered the death of all the Hebrew baby boys around the birth of Moses. Matthew goes on to say that after Jesus comes back from Egypt, he gets baptized in the Jordan River. Right. In a similar way, Israel, as they returned to the promised land, they crossed the river Jordan to get into the promised land. In the same way, as Jesus was about to begin his ministry, he crosses into the Jordan River and he comes out of it, with God's blessing and God's confirming that this is his beloved son. And what happens to Jesus right after his baptism, after he comes out of the River Jordan, he is taken for 40 days into the desert to be tempted by Satan. Right? And if you think about 40, well, that sounds kind of familiar. Well, Israel, because of their failure, the first time they went into the river, they didn't really cross. They went to the River Jordan. They failed, and they were led into the wilderness for 40 years of wandering. Right, 40 years where they continue to reject God, they continue to fail, we see that Jesus withstands the temptation of Satan for those 40 days that he is in the wilderness. And it goes on and on. But my point is, right, what we see here is Matthew is crafting what he's writing with care, guided by the Holy Spirit, to show that in every way that Israel failed, Jesus succeeded. Right? Jesus experienced, in many ways, the same events as the history of Israel, maybe more condensed, of course. And yet, every point where Israel failed, Jesus succeeded. Jesus is the greater son. Jesus is the one who can actually fulfill the responsibilities given to Israel, and so much more. So Jesus' birth is really a picture of Israel's entire heritage and history up to that point. And before we move on to our second point, I need to think of this as an aside. You know, if you read the textbook, this would be one of those boxes, like pop out, that gives you a little extra information. This is important because this gets into issues of prophecy. Right? Like I said before, if you pay very close attention when you read Matthew, you come away scratching your head. You'd be like, Matthew, how did you connect this verse with Jesus? And you may be wondering, well, it seems Matthew is kind of loosey-goosey with the way he uses scripture. He's like, oh, you know, Jesus was in Egypt. Israel was in Egypt. Let's find a verse, you know, oh, out of Egypt, I called my son. Let's attach that to Jesus, right? Some people think this is evidence that, you know, the scripture was just written by human beings. They think, well, you know, they're not following any rules. They're just kind of pulling verses left and right. And it's helpful for us to understand, well, how does prophecy work exactly? What actually counts as a prophecy, right? Because I mentioned before, you look at Hosea 11:1, you wouldn't think, oh, this is a prophecy. I'm going to look for fulfillment. Out of Egypt, I called my son. So what's helpful, and we're not going to spend too much time on this, what's helpful is to realize when we read the Old Testament, there are two broad ways that future events are hinted at. Okay, the first way is direct prophecy. Well, when you have, you know, explicit statements like God is saying, this is going to happen, and you need to pay attention, right? Those parts are usually very clear. Usually they are spoken by a prophet, and it's usually capped off by something like, thus saith the Lord, right? Or something explicit like, this will happen. I am going to do this. I am going to do that. Something very explicit. Direct predictions. An example about how this applies to Jesus would be the prophecy in Micah, right? From Bethlehem shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Very explicit prophecy. So when it happens, you're like, ah, well, that is fulfillment, right? Direct prediction. If you can think of it, these are kind of like, if you're reading a map, these are the step-by-step instructions and directions that you can get, right? Those are easy, and those are kind of the ones that we should focus on, right? You focus on the obvious and the explicit stuff. The second kind of kind of prophetic language that hints at future events is what we call a type. Okay, this is a theological term. There are types that we find in the Old Testament, and you can think of this maybe this is helpful for some of our younger students. Think of these as Easter eggs, okay? You guys understand what I'm saying. Sometimes in movies or in TV shows, there are Easter eggs that refer to things that will happen in the future or things that have come before. They're little clues that if you pay attention, you'll find, even though it doesn't really have any bearing on the movie or book you're reading or you're watching at that moment. It has significance later, but it's a little clue that was left in there. And this is what Hosea is. When you read the book of Hosea, you shouldn't think, well, this was a prophecy. You should know that this was referring to Jesus in the future. You should read it as is. It's talking about Israel, right? God called Israel out of Egypt as a son. They failed, right? We believe there's only one meaning to each passage of Scripture. There's no double meanings. But after Jesus came, Matthew is looking back and he says, whoa, there's some clues, there's some hints of what Jesus is going through, right? And this is one of those. An example I can think of, maybe this is helpful, is, you know, if you're a kid, right, you ask your parents for a car. You're like, Dad, Mom, get me a car, right? And you're like 6 years old. They're not going to get you a car, but they may get you a little power wheel, right, that's shaped like a real car, and you can have some fun, drive it around, right? But once you turn 16, or once you get your driver's license, and if you're really lucky, I have really, you know, rich parents, they'll actually buy you a real version of that car. That's sort of the idea. You have these imperfect clues in the Old Testament that when Jesus comes in the New Testament, people look back and say, ah, well, that kind of hinted at who Jesus is going to be. It's a way to help people recognize that Jesus is the real deal when they look at sort of the imperfect clues in the past. Okay, so like I said, this is sort of an aside, but I think it's helpful going forward because you can get into a lot of confusing situations if you don't kind of understand this breakdown. And people have had all sorts of wild theories and wild theology because they didn't properly understand this breakdown. Some other popular types of Jesus comparisons that we even see in Scripture is when Jesus was compared to Jonah, right? Just as Jonah spent 3 days in the fish, so too did Jesus spend 3 days in the grave. Now, when you read Jonah, were you supposed to know that? Oh, this is referring to Jesus. No. But when you look back, you see, well, hey, this idea of being kind of buried or submerged for 3 days has significance, right? So things like that. So in conclusion, right, we need to pay attention. I would say pay attention more to the direct prophecy, okay? It's harder to go wrong with those. Focus on that. There's enough there for us to look at, and there's more than enough direct prophecies to really prove the birth and the validity of Christ. Think of the types as, I would say, as Easter eggs. These are just bonuses. So if you really study Scripture, you can be like, oh, cool, there's these cool connections between Old Testament and New Testament. It gives you a fuller picture. It gives you a greater understanding of Jesus, but it's not going to be like foundational stuff, right? This prophecy that out of Egypt, God calls his son, is great to know and great to see this connection that Jesus is the greater son. But if you don't quite get it, that's okay, right? Jesus is still Lord, and he still died on the cross for our sins, and all the prophecies about him are true. So hopefully this is helpful. Jesus' birth portrays Israel's heritage in very explicit ways and in more subtle ways, and this is one of the more subtle ways. So let's move on. And here is the most important point. Right, we see that Matthew takes great pains to show the similarities between Jesus and Israel, but this is the difference. Jesus' obedience, in contrast to Israel's rebellion, he perfects Israel's potential. He did what Israel was supposed to do, and so much more. By living his perfect life here on earth, he became the perfect high priest for all sinners. Right? We don't need to turn to any nation. We don't need to turn to any priesthood. We don't need to turn to any other organization. We turn to Christ as our perfect mediator. Right? And beyond his priesthood, Jesus is also the perfect king. Psalm 2, verses 7 through 9, this is, you know, another one of those more explicit references, explicit prophecy. The Lord said to me, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel." Jesus will not only perfectly bring God's message to the nations, ultimately, Jesus will perfectly rule over all the nations. We see in Psalm 89, where it talks about, "Now, this is the firstborn, and I will make him," talking about the Messiah, "the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love, I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his offspring forever and his throne as the days of the heavens." Right? Jesus will perfectly fulfill what Israel could not, have a kingdom that lasts forever. And here's where it applies to us. You may think, well, that's well and good, all right, that's fine, I understand, okay, Israel failed, Jesus succeeded, that's great. Well, why is this important for us? The book of Hebrews, in fact, is the book that kind of ties everything together anyway, but Hebrews 2, 10 and 11 makes it clear. "It was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things existed, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers." Why is it so important that we understand the greater sonship of Jesus, everything that he came to fulfill? Well, it is because That is the reason we are made children of God. Right? Israel had that mission first. Right? Through Israel, God would bless all the nations of the earth. They failed. Only through Jesus did salvation come to Gentiles, to the rest of the world. Only through Jesus, the greater firstborn, can all of us become sons and daughters of God. And we can have confidence that this perfect son, he's not, you know, like some stuck-up firstborn eldest son who looks down on his siblings. I hope that's not true in your family, but it could be true. But this eldest son, through suffering, he redeemed his adopted, sinful, fallen brothers and sisters. He says he is not ashamed to call them brothers. Right now, Jesus is so much more than that, but in a sense, Jesus is our spiritual big brother when we look at this idea of sonship. And that's not all he is, so don't get me wrong. He is Lord, he is King, he is God, but he chooses to identify and to call us his brothers, even though we do not deserve it. And it is only through him that we can become sons and daughters of God likewise. So I'll close with one more story about an interesting sibling pair. The young lady on the left there, she's the little baby in that first picture. Her name is Marissa Ayala. And her birth was very interesting because her birth was planned from the very beginning to save a life. Now, this is an amazing story. What happened was Marissa's older sister, she had leukemia. And she was 16 years old. They tried everything to look for a donor amongst the relatives, friends, strangers. This was back in the 80s. And nothing seemed to work. And it seemed like this elder daughter was destined to die. The parents had a crazy idea that this is a long shot, but if we had another child, maybe this child would be a match for the eldest daughter. Right now, they faced many hardships, even with low chances of conceiving. And even if they were to conceive and have a healthy child, there was only a 1 in 4 chance that this child's blood type or the bone marrow type would match. But that's what they decided to do. Right now, there's some controversy around this. People are wondering whether it was ethical or not. And there may be some legitimate debate there. But what happened was that this child who was conceived was the right match. The elder sister lived long enough for her youngest sister to be old enough to donate her blood and bone marrow, and she saved her sister's life. And this picture on the right is at Marissa's graduation back in 2013 from college. And that's her sister on the right. And Marissa, according to her, she has no regrets. She was very, you know, grateful of the opportunity to save her sister's life even before she was aware of it, right? And interesting story, right? Maybe some questions there, but, man, I cannot think of perhaps a better picture of what we talked about today, the younger, chronologically, son being born to rescue and save the life of the older, and through that to save our lives as well. See, the birth of Jesus is many things, but it is a rescue. Right? Jesus was born so that he can shed his blood for sinners, so he can give his life that those who are dead in their trespasses and sin can be made alive again. So as we come to a conclusion today, right, my question is, you may celebrate Christmas, you may even celebrate the birth of Christ, but have you trusted in Christ as your Savior, as the one whose blood will cleanse your sins? If you haven't, I encourage you, I invite you to do so today. Let me close in a word of prayer. Father God, there is so much richness and depth in your word. And I know that people have been searching and scouring scriptures for hundreds, thousands of years, looking for clues and signs of the coming of Christ. Lord, I thank you that we have your completed word in our hands, both the Old and New Testament, the fullness of your revelation to us. I thank you that we have that. I thank you we have the complete gospel, that we are not looking forward and awaiting the birth of Christ, but we are looking back and celebrating the birth of Christ. We are celebrating his life, his perfect life, and Lord, we can remember and commemorate his death on the cross. But most of all, Lord, I thank you for the fact of his resurrection. Lord, that he triumphed over death and sin in order to make fallen sinners your children. Lord, I pray that all of us here can seriously consider the life of Christ, Lord. And for those of us who have trusted in him, may we celebrate and rejoice and share this good news. And for those who haven't, Lord, I pray that they will turn to your perfect son to become your son and daughter. Lord, we just thank you again for this time. We pray these things in your son's precious name. Amen.
All right, let's stand at this time and sing, "Great is thy faithfulness."
Your mercy, how pleasing you find.
your pleasure that you are my joy. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord God, to me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with death. Great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
You may be seated. At this time, before Pastor Tim comes up, just want to let you all know, in case you didn't know, that we're going to be having an upcoming program. Our teams have been working very, very diligently for several months already. And the program is called Behold the Lamb of God. Now, normally we have a Christmas service before actual Christmas, but this year Christmas happens to be on a Saturday the 25th. So we're going to have it the day after. It's still close, right? It's still close to Christmas. So we're going to have it after this year. So we can. For those of you who get your Christmas tree out and you're decorating your house early, like 2 months early, you can still extend your Christmas holiday. It doesn't have to be over yet. Good news for some, who cares for others? It's all right. So, but we invite you to come. We're going to have in the English service, as you see, it says 9 a.m. But I want to also invite, if you have Cantonese family or friends who would like to attend, we're going to be duplicating that, a little bit amending it at our 11 o'clock service. And we would like to invite any Cantonese relatives or friends that you might know on the Chinese side who would also like to participate in this program that they would be able to come to. So 9 o'clock for the English, 11 o'clock for the Cantonese service. So come on out, bring your family, bring your friends, and we're so excited about this opportunity. We're gonna be seeing a lot of what Pastor Tim and Pastor Theron have been talking about in the Old Testament and about how Jesus fulfills that. So that's what this year's Christmas program is about. So please make your plans to attend and invite your friends and loved ones to attend as well. Pastor Tim.
One quick additional announcement. The 2022 church directory, we have a draft that's available for you to proofread that you can check after or when you check in for worship services. You make sure you check your information during the IBF time or after the Cantonese service or after the Mandarin service, and you can see the information up there. So just make sure you double check your information, and the final copy will be distributed after we get everybody's information set. There will be no soft copies, no electronic copies. It'll only be a hard copy. That way, we don't want the information to be too easily spread for everybody's contact info. With that, if I can invite you to stand as we close our time together, let's pray. Father, will you go with us as we depart from this place, Lord? Will you help us to find our hope, our security, our joy in you, in your Son? And Lord, may you fill us with your Spirit, fill us with your joy, and Lord, help us to be bold witnesses to you, for you, Lord. And it is in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You guys are dismissed. We'll see you in IVF.
Emmanuel, Emmanuel, you are the God who saved us, worthy of all our praises. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here.